is 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition. Liftoff. Liftoff.
Hello and welcome to AWS Made Easy episode number 97. This is the show where we interview guests from AWS. We talk about the latest news in AWS and generative AI with an eye towards cost optimization. We review AWS news and try to answer your questions. I'm Stephen Barr.
And I'm Rahul Subramaniam. Welcome to this amazing episode. We have so much packed in for the show today. Stephen, what are we going to look forward to?
Oh, we have several news articles. We're also going to try out Gemini Pro. Now, this has the 1 million token context window. I'm excited to try out that. We're going to try it on a bit of video from ourselves comparing GPT-4 and Claude 3 Opus. So we're using one AI to compare, to summarize our own discussion, talking about two other AIs. So very meta. We're going to talk about several AWS and announcements, including one about Compute Optimizer. Great. It's going to be a great show.
Looking forward to it. But before we get started, Stephen, how was your weekend?
Really, really, really good. We went to this math festival, which is an annual thing. I went to it last year. That was really good. They have lots of math activities set up for the kids. They're all staffed by volunteers locally. They have different stations for different age appropriate. The kids go around and they have a little sheet of stamps. The sheet gets stamped as they complete the different activities. That was a lot of fun. Nice. Had some dinner with some friends and yeah, it was really, really good. How about you?
Sounds like a lot of fun. So out here in India, yesterday was Holi. So, you know, big celebrations. It's a celebration of colors. A lot of fun. I remember your kids playing Holi last year, wasn't it?
Yes, that was at the Pacific Science or at the Seattle Center.
Yeah. So that was yesterday over here. But over the weekend, a cousin of mine had come down. We are starting to build a little group of divers or cousins who are divers. So one of my cousins flew down and we went diving. I did three dives off the coast of Pondicherry, which is about a 2 hours drive from here. And it was fabulous.
Oh, neat.
Yeah, so the visibility could have been better, but we spotted two octopuses or octopi. We spotted a bunch of boxfish, tons of lionfish. It was actually really fun. A lot of hermit crabs. Yeah.
Okay, so this is scuba.
This is scuba diving, yes.
How deep do you go?
We're certified to go up to 30 meters, but
okay.
On this particular one, we went up to 21 meters.
Wow, so, what a blast.
A lot of fun. Yeah. Very tiring, but a lot of fun at the same time.
Okay, so that's 2 hours south of you?
Yes, that's 2 hours further south. And there's a little union territory called Pondicherry. And there are a bunch of very interesting dive sites just off the shore. So pretty neat. And I'm waiting for May, June, July, where that's the season for the whale sharks to come in. And that site is supposed to be absolutely fascinating. So I can't wait to go there this summer.
Wow, that's really fun. I've never scuba'd before. I've free dived before. When I lived in Australia, I did a bit of that, but never scuba.
Yeah, so the interesting thing is I got Nitrox certified, which allows me to stay down longer, so we could actually do three drives, otherwise we wouldn't be able to. But it was so much fun, and I keep learning new things. So I did not know that the Indian Ocean, especially around the area around South India where I am, and Sri Lanka, that's native to the blue whales, native to the whale sharks, and there's tons of amazing marine life just around you.
Isn't it surprising, like, what's just under the surface when you jump in, right? It looks all uniform when you're above and you jump in and you think, okay, there's little bits of structure, there's little rocks, there's little reefs, and you can see how these bits of structure become so pivotal for the fish there. You give them good places to hide and to
exactly
get shelter.
And it's a whole other world. Like, there's nothing that is comparable to things on land. We've discovered a lot of stuff on land, but the stuff in the water still continues to be, you know, unseen and unknown. So I just love the experience of diving. And most importantly, it's meditative. The only sound you hear under the water is your own breath. And that, if you keep doing that for like 45 minutes when you're in a dive, there's nothing that beats, you know, that form of meditation.
Now, did you get into this because of the deep dive principle? Is this part of Dive Deep?
Not at all. I started my diving experiences about 12 years ago. And the first time I did a dive, just, you know, exploring what diving might feel like, I was immediately hooked. And then we just get, you know, my wife and I both started getting certified for more complicated stuff, and then traveling around the world, wherever we got an opportunity, we took the opportunity to dive.
Okay, have you done it at night? Because that looks, yes, to me like, okay, that looks terrifying.
So yes, so we both got certified in what is called advanced open water diving, and night dives are a requirement for that certification. And it is absolutely terrifying when you get started, because you're going in and you see absolutely nothing.
And everything can see you.
That's actually not really. So unless you literally take a torch and shine it on your face, no one can see you.
But everything can see the point of light, right? I mean,
correct. They can see the point of light. And so you don't know what's 2 inches next to you unless someone shines a light on it. But the kinds of stuff you see in the night is absolutely fascinating. I've seen starfish about this big come down a reef. I've seen sharks go after turtles inside a reef cave. I've seen parrotfish sleep with a mucus, you know, layer around them so that sharks don't smell them. It's fascinating to see these things.
I'm going to take your word for it. In Australia, they have this funny shark called the wobbegong shark. And I remember I swam over this ledge, and it was kind of like a little rock cave. And the sharks are about this big. They're very small, and they're very curious. And there's just a pile of them. They kind of sleep in these little piles. And they were just kind of all laying in a pile, just relaxing. It was just such a strange sight. This is their element. I'm a guest in this world for as long as I can hold my breath. And then I'm going back up.
Now, you should try, if you love freediving, you should just try scuba diving once and see if that appeals to you.
Yeah, definitely. Well, the strangest thing for me is, you know, there were gray nurse sharks, and they're not scary, but they want to, you know, they're also wandering around. But just one could be right next to you so quickly, and if you're not observant, you'll never hear it. It would just all of a sudden there's a enormous, well, they're not big in terms of sharks go, but they're big in terms of what's out in the water next to you.
But they're usually more scared of you than you are of them. And they don't generally approach humans unless they've been trained to do so.
Well, and it's one of those things in your mind. You have to, you tell yourself that in your mind. Yeah, this thing's scared of me. And you have to keep telling yourself that.
Now, I've been around enough sharks during dives, but that's been the general observation. They try and stay away from you as much as possible. I've never seen one come close during any of our dives.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah, I've seen them be curious, but not aggressive.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Oh, and I also did a bunch of 3D printing this weekend, but I want to share you that later, because I wrote a little article on the similarities between generative AI and 3D printing. So I want to share with you a little bit later in the show.
Looking forward to it. Okay, should we dive right in with some very important announcements that came out from AWS? And let's go through those.
Okay, let's start with announcement number one. I'll put this up on the screen. This is the Bedrock Generative AI Chat Blueprint for Amazon Code Catalyst. Let's do our 60-second take and then dive a little bit deeper in.
Sure.
Oop, not that tab, this tab. Okay. Introducing the Bedrock Gen AI Code Catalyst Chat Blueprint. What do you think about this one? Who's going to use this? What does it enable?
Okay, so for anyone trying to get started and very quickly deploy a chatbot, the Code Catalyst Blueprints are the way AWS recommends you run some of these, especially if you're just trying to stitch together a whole bunch of different services. Now, we'll dive a little bit deeper into it. I am not a heavy user of Code Catalyst because it seems to do a lot of magic stuff under the hood. They don't really document all of it really well. There's generally an architecture diagram, but there isn't a lot more details about exactly what is done with all the code in there. So,
okay, so how do you review and rate this one?
Why don't we hold the rating and review of this till we actually try it out?
All right, that sounds good. Great. I do have to mention, as a shameless plug for my friend Darko, he has the project called Bedrust, and he has added chat conversation functionality to Bedrust. So this is how to use Bedrock from Rust. It's really nice, and he's using generative AI to build it. It's a really simple command line oriented program, but it's great. Yes, yeah, there we go. He just added chat. You can actually have a conversation with LLMs now. So it's not single shot anymore. It's contextual conversation.
Great.
And it's supporting Sonnet and Haiku. And as soon as Opus is released, it will surely support that too. As long as your wallet supports it.
Sounds good. Now, I can't wait for Opus to be available on Bedrock. I'm waiting for that announcement to be made.
That is an exciting one. Hopefully this week, fingers crossed. I've asked around and I have a few unofficial hypotheses as to what the delay is. But it'll all be speculative. Hopefully we see it and it has a nice pricing model soon.
Looking forward to it. Okay, shall we move on to the next one?
Yes. Okay, for our next article, AWS Compute Optimizer now supports 51 new EC2 instance types. Rahul, what's the impact of this change? What are the new instance types? What are we excited about with this one?
Okay, so AWS, I'm very, very kicked about this. For those of you who are new to the show, AWS Compute Optimizer is a service from AWS that gives you recommendations about how to right-size your instances. It is really, really conservative in its predictions, but can save you tons of money as you take up those recommendations. Now, with this particular announcement, we've already got support for, I think, a few hundred instance types already out of the 600 odd. And now we've added 50 more new instance types. Now, the amazing thing about these ones are that they include a bunch of instances that are related to HPC workloads. There are a bunch of them that are memory optimized instances and a few of the compute optimized instances as well. There are AMD instances that you can switch to, which is great. And most importantly, if you're already on Intel, the C6 variants of the C6i and the R6i, you can now upgrade to the next generation, which is the fourth generation of Intel, but the seventh generation of the C7 Intel instance types. And these offer 15% better performance compared to the previous generation of instances. So there is a ton to look forward to in terms of these recommendations. And the amazing thing is that because we work so closely with the Compute Optimizer team, all of these 51 recommendations are now available immediately on CloudFix. You can go check out CloudFix, and the analyzer will now start presenting these recommendations as well, right out of the box. You have to do nothing. So if you haven't done that already, you want to get a quick report about what your instance, your more optimal instance types are going to be for your specific workloads, please check out CloudFix. And more importantly, also check out the previous episodes where we have spoken to Rick Ox about how Compute Optimizer works. We will hopefully put it down somewhere here.
It is episode number 66, and we did a special 66 and a half episode. We already had 67 scheduled, but then the GPU compute the GPU support was added to Optimizer, so we had to have Rick back on. It was really nice of him to give another. We thought it was going to be a 5-minute segment, it ended up being a 35-minute episode. It was really neat. GPUs, their compute performance is very different than CPUs. GPUs, you want 100% utilization.
Correct.
Whereas Compute Optimizer, you do not want 100% CPU utilization. This is a very exciting announcement. I want to dive a little bit deeper into this. Just real quick, how do you rate this one on a 1 to 5 cloud scale? And does this simplify?
I'm a huge fan of what AWS Compute Optimizer does. And so I'm going to give this a 5. It's rare, but this is really important. So there's tons of money to be saved over here. The conservative approach that AWS Compute Optimizer takes to making the recommendations to ensure that it's absolutely safe is something that is a win-win for every customer. So I give it a 5 clouds. And it definitely simplifies the life of customers because they don't have to worry about trying to figure out what the right sizing, you know, transition is, needs to be. So super thrilled about it.
Awesome. Now looking at the details, it is in basically all the regions. They're listing them all individually, but it looks like all of them. It
would be better. All the major regions that have been around for a while are all over here.
They've got the AMD, the Epic Genoa, the HPC 7A, metal-sized instances. Metal's a bit more nuanced, but they've got them there. That means if you are using the entire physical machine and you don't want any hypervisor at all,
correct.
They've got metal if you want it.
And I think with this, they cover everything. I just read the line over here that says that with this, the total number of EC2 instance types supported is 702. So I think, I don't know what else is left. I think they covered pretty much everything now.
Maybe the FPGA instances or something like that. The really esoteric ones. Or the virtual M1.smalls.
Yeah, possibly. But yeah, there's so much money to be saved with running this. And if you remember some of the conversations, we'll try and do a quick highlight of these. I think we are planning to bring Rick on the show later this week, and we will bring that to you as soon as we can get that scheduled.
He will be making an appearance for episode 100. That will be a brief appearance, and then we have a full episode with just Rick. He has been really busy. Check out his LinkedIn for all the announcements, but we're working on scheduling, figuring out the time zones. We're really excited to have him appear as soon as he can.
And Rick is the senior product manager responsible for AWS Compute Optimizer. No one knows this stuff better than him. So we will hear about all these enhancements, you know, straight from his mouth. So I'm really looking forward to that conversation. Hopefully later this week.
And I discovered he is on X now, too. So I'll put some of the links in the description. I think for a second, let's take off our AWS Made Easy hats for a second and put on our CloudFix hats. He said, CloudFix, we're out there to save you money, make sure you use your resources efficiently. And one would think, okay, wait, AWS does Compute Optimizer. We're out there. We want to optimize your compute. And yet, how do we work together? Right, so we surface those Compute Optimizer recommendations. We don't want to reinvent the wheel where AWS already has that. But what we do is we take these recommendations and we make it super easy. We filter them. We surface the low risk or the very low risk ones, put them in the dashboard, and you hit execute, and they're ready to go all in one place, along with all of your other cost saving measures that you can take with CloudFix. So, Compute Optimizer is one. There's a Compute Optimizer API, and of course, you're welcome to write calls directly to that API, and we've got blog posts showing you how to do that, what Compute Optimizer is. But if you're a CloudFix customer, or if you want to be a CloudFix customer, you'll see that in the dashboard, ready to go.
Compute Optimizer is an amazing finder and makes all these amazing recommendations for how to right size. And what CloudFix is the fixer. It actually fixes the problem and does the execution in a safe and AWS recommended way. So if you haven't checked out CloudFix already, please try out the free assessment at cloudfix.com. It only takes a few minutes. And with that, you will know exactly where and how you can save tons of money on AWS.
and bringing up that finder fixer terminology. So many of them, CloudFix is doing the finding, right? We're looking through the cost and usage report. We're looking through CloudWatch. But in this case, Compute Optimizer is going to do the finding.
So exactly.
We're not, if you heard other of our episodes, we're not into reinventing the wheel. So we have it here. We're going to use it. Compute Optimizer will find it. We'll make it easy for you to fix it.
Correct.
Savings plans. This is a very short announcement. What do you think about this one?
I actually like this. There are a lot of times when you make a mistake and you make a commitment, and once you start analyzing or you start sharing your decision with the rest of your teammates, you realize, oh, I could have done better than this, or I made a mistake because we didn't account for something. And this is a great way to kind of roll back a decision that you made. So within 7 days, you can return your savings plans. And, you know, like savings plans are good for a whole number of different cases, and you want to make sure that you're buying just the right amount and you're predicting, you know, how much exactly you're going to be using. You should be conservative in what you purchase. And sometimes customers are not, or they don't understand exactly what they're getting into with these commitments with AWS, because you're either tied into a 1-year commitment or a 3-year commitment. So in case you make an error in exactly what you needed to buy or in your predictions of what you're going to spend over the next 1 or 3 years, this gives you a little window to roll back some of those decisions that you might have made. So definitely simplifies life for a lot of developers. This is a kind of a safety hatch to get out of a long-term commitment in case you decide that you want to take a different decision. And so I like it. So I think it simplifies, and I'd give it a 4-star or a 4-cloud.
Excellent. You know, I saw Rick announce this. I'll share this tab. Today we're announcing savings plan returns. This was a couple of days ago. Yeah. He got a lot of traction on this post. Right, there we go. 700 reactions. I posted to him and said, this is great. We don't even need to take our savings plans over to the Whole Foods. We can return it.
The interesting thing would be to figure out how often you can do this, because I wonder if you can keep buying savings plan. Like, you know, if you were to take a very, twisted view of this, keep buying savings plans for 7 days and keep returning them on the 6th day, and then buy them again and then return them again. I wonder if there are going to be limits to doing this.
Well, I guess like any other return policies, right? This is so classic in US case, you have Costco and they have an extremely liberal return policy.
Yeah.
And every year, right after Christmas, you see people returning Christmas trees. And you think, really? And you'd hope that their account is flagged somehow. I mean, this is such an egregious abuse of the return policy.
No, it absolutely is.
So hopefully this gives people confidence, and like anything else, there's going to be a few people who abuse it, and hopefully there's some mechanism that doesn't ruin it for everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. We'll dive a little bit more into the details of how this works and what are the limitations, but definitely a good thing for now.
Yeah. I'm sure if anyone could figure out that mechanism, Amazon can. They've been dealing with returns for a long time.
Couldn't agree more. Life for a lot of devs, and you'll get the latencies very.
Okay, next one, private link. Let's pull up this tab. DynamoDB now supports AWS private link. So, Rahul, give us a quick 10-second, what is private link, and then why is it important that DynamoDB now supports it?
Okay, so private link is basically a secure way of connecting your on-premise data centers to the AWS cloud and the services within them. One of the biggest issues with AWS pricing is the networking costs that are involved.
And so you can basically treat DynamoDB as on your local network.
Correct. And you'll get the latencies, very low latency connections, thanks to these private links. And they're all secure. It's your data. It's a point-to-point connection, basically. So I'm going to give this a neat 4-star and simplifies, for sure.
Yeah, I can imagine that that would be really helpful, especially in a transition period where you want to assume that DynamoDB is local, and then eventually it will be.
Yeah, I think this applies to most services. As you're transitioning over to the cloud, you're not going to have everything moved over on day one. You're going to move things, you know, one by one. The resources that are and can be run in AWS and can be moved easily from an on-prem system, move those first. Have the private link be your connection between your data center and AWS, and keep moving more and more workloads over to AWS as you do that. In the meantime, everything continues to operate seamlessly thanks to the private link.
Excellent. All right, let's take a 1-minute break, and we come back. I want to show you what I think is a good link between 3D printing and generative AI. And I want you to see if you believe it, or see if I went off the deep end here.
Great.
All right, I'll be right back. All right, well, as we both know, we both enjoy 3D printing. I was thinking about this over the weekend. So I'm working on, for the 100th episode, launching a site where you'll be able to fully search all of, not just our episodes, but articles, clips, everything all in one place, and interact with it, putting it into a RAG. And so as part of that, I was making sure that all of the metadata, so all the dates and times, and you know, everything was all nice and clean. I had a few episodes with missing transcripts, a few bit of data issues. And so I dedicated my Saturday night. I was just working through cleaning all that up. And it got me thinking. So I was using, in this case, ChatGPT. I was using ChatGPT to create functions as I needed them.
Got it.
And it was a really pleasant development experience. And I was thinking, okay, in the past, if I didn't have AI to help me, I would have tried to come up with this very complicated framework, right? Some generalized way of doing it. And I would have thought, okay, I don't want to maintain this code. I don't want to write it more than once. I would have started thinking about what are unanticipated use cases, make sure my code is extensible and modular. And I know where this ends up. Right, I ended up making this big this mess, and then my requirements change before that investment of time that I made ever pays off.
Yeah,
and you know, I kind of tricked myself into over-engineering the solution. But with AI, I thought, okay, I could type in something like, given a YouTube URL, and this is one of the functions I needed, give me the upload date of that video to YouTube.
Yeah,
and I could have written that myself, but I just typed it in and a minute later I had something. It pulled in a library called PyTube. You add that to the requirements.txt, put it in a function, test it. It works every time. Okay, great. I was able to backfill some of that missing metadata. And I just made this personal library called sjbutil. And I just put all of my AI generated functions into this library.
Got it.
And basically each script just did one thing. And I could fill in any missing metadata, run my pile of scripts again, and it was fun and it worked. And so it got me thinking, okay, this has really changed for me my mental cost model of code.
Yeah.
And before I used to think, okay, code, I need to write code that will run for months to kind of justify its existence. And now I think, okay, this code, if it runs once, it's already paid the investment of me prompting an AI, hitting copy paste. And if it runs just in this one-off task, it's already justified its existence.
Correct.
And that's totally changed, you know, my mental cost model. And so I wrote about this. Like, I'm no longer thinking about, is this code going to pay off in the long run? Here we go. I'm quoting myself here. I used to worry that each line of code I wrote would need to be maintained, and therefore it had to be beautifully general. And now Gen AI can make code that I'm happy to just run it once.
Yeah.
And I know in the future, if I want to run it, adapt it to something, I don't have to think ahead about how will I adapt this to some unforeseen use case, because in the future I will also have AI, I hope. Unless something catastrophic happens, I will also have AI. And so I can make the change then. So I was thinking, you know, this is similar to 3D printing, right? With 3D printing, you start to think about physical things like this drawer I'm making. This didn't exist 24 hours ago.
Yeah.
But I wanted it, and now it does. And you start to think about things as ephemeral. And my wife and I, she had this really neat idea for a way of displaying art using some cheap slats. And we thought of a bracket that we can print out. Now, before 3D printing, you think, okay, well, I could get someone to make this bracket, or I could try and make it myself. And then I would really have to think through, what are the failure modes? Is it worth it to have it made? Is this exactly what I want aesthetically? Should I get it done in the right color? Maybe I should have a batch of 500 made and sell the 490 that I don't need on Etsy. All these silly things where that's not what I want to do. I just want this one bracket. And it doesn't have to be perfect. It just has to exist. And then it's going to break, or when I'm going to use it, I'm going to figure out some other way of why it's not good enough. And then I'll make a better one. Yeah. And then that one will exist. And so I really thought, wow, so both 3D printing and generative AI have kind of changed this mental cost model, where you're not thinking about how it has to be perfect. You're just thinking, I just want something that works, and I can have it working right now. And also, tell me if this is, I'm going to show this on the article. This is one of my daughters came up to me with this diagram she made, because we have this board game at home, and it has this little holder made of cardboard where you have to hold your little chips that you collect. And it's really cheap, and it's not fun to use. And so she came up with this diagram of a 3D printable one. Now, this was her first one. She wrote the dimensions. And then we ended up on this. And this existed like an hour after she wanted it. And now this is much more satisfying to use for the board game.
You know, the old model, like you said, was you started off with the assumption that your code had to last a long time. And, you know, in my living through managing billions of lines of code, I've kind of realized that's the wrong model. And it doesn't even work for, you know, the last decade or more. The model that I started adopting, you know, before Gen AI came about, was that you have to figure out how to delete code easily. If that is what your team focuses on, make the assumption that the code that you have is not going to last very long and should be deleted quickly. You invariably have to use coding best practices to write that kind of code so that it's easy to delete and replace with something newer, something better, something that has a good seam that'll allow it to be replaced with something else. With Gen AI, I think when it comes to smaller projects and smaller prototypes, which is what most people are attempting right now, I would say this totally works. If your use case is small, I'm just going to do a chatbot, or I'm going to do one thing and just one thing alone, then it totally makes sense to just have Gen AI generate a one-time code. Assume that it's a one-time thing. You're never going to maintain it. And if you have to maintain it, you just generate it again with some new specifications or some new requirements in it. That completely makes sense for most use cases that are relatively small in scope. I am waiting to see how this evolves over the long run, where I do believe that the medium to long run model is still going to be generate maintainable code. And what I mean by maintainable code is code that is easy to delete. It has good seams. It has a good structure. But it is generated by AI, where at the function level, everything is replaceable. You don't replace everything in the entire code base, but you replace one function at a time. Yet the function is kind of encapsulated in a much better structure, which makes this function replaceable with another function or another implementation of the function.
Yeah, I agree completely. And to add to that, I guess for me, I made sure that every script that I wrote here, it was idempotent.
Yeah.
And so I didn't have to worry about, okay, what order do I need to run these scripts in? Could they be destructive if I ran them all at once? And literally, we are the limiting factor, right? This is managing the metadata for our live stream. If we live stream once a day for the next decade, this is still going to be fine. That's
absolutely,
it's in the thousands, right? Yeah, we're not talking about
the other point IoT that you mentioned here about over-engineering. That's something to be very cautious about. You really have to wonder whether you need that kind of code, which you're going to have to maintain for the next 10 years or whatever. I don't think that's true in 99% of the cases.
Well, and you see it, right? Like, I used to go down this rabbit hole all the time. You see people with their personal blog, and the first step in how to start your personal blog is like, install Kubernetes.
Yeah.
I hope that everyone's personal blog is that busy that you need state-of-the-art container management software to service it. But it shouldn't be, right? It should be find your S3 bucket and make it public.
Correct. Or exactly. Recording?
Yep.
Okay, so we're going to run Gemini 1.5 Pro through its paces. And the amazing thing about this model, and I've been very excited to get my hands on it, is the fact that you have a million tokens that you can use to do a bunch of very interesting stuff. So I have access over here. I brought it up on screen. Why don't we try an exercise where we pull up a clip from one of our previous episodes and just ask it a bunch of questions. I think video analysis is unique to Gemini 1.5 Pro. All other Vision API don't support video analysis. Claude 3 only supports images in the JPEG, web image format, and PNG format. And so this would be a good experiment. Let's see what it does. So I'm going to take a clip that we looked at, and then so I'm going to say upload video. I am going to pull up a file that we took, and this, Stephen, is a 7-minute clip or thereabouts.
Yes. Now this is a clip. Now this is very meta. This is a video clip of us reviewing a Hacker News discussion of the pros and cons of Claude 3 Opus versus GPT-4 Turbo.
Correct.
So you and I were talking about the Hacker News discussion where different users were weighing in on their thoughts. And we were kind of synthesizing, seeing if we agreed or disagreed. So this is a AI analysis of a discussion about AI.
Correct. So this is going to be very interesting. So as you can see at the bottom of my screen, this is, of course, preview, but I have a million tokens as my budget for this chat. So very excited about it. The model is Gemini 1.5 Pro. Temperature is set to 2. We'll just see how this performs. Now, the larger the context that you're submitting into the LLM, the longer everything takes. So what we see with Gemini Pro is that it actually takes a bunch of time to process the context of whatever's uploaded to it. We'll give it another few minutes.
Do we know what's happening behind the scenes right now? Are they dividing it into screenshots and making a transcript? Are they?
I'm guessing that it's breaking it up into a bunch of frames, and I don't know what intervals it uses to analyze frames. But it's probably taking a bunch of different frames and creating context based on those frames. So as I understand it, this is about... So most other LLMs use about 1,000 tokens per frame. So we'll see how many frames this creates. I think 7 minutes works out to roughly about 115,000 frames. 115,000 tokens. So that's about 115 frames that it builds over 7 minutes.
Plus a transcript. So I think it's going to take a transcript. And it's also...
Correct.
On the frames, doing things like text detection.
Correct. And it probably does a bunch of that. But that is probably going to run on the frames themselves. So let's just do a quick math. So 7 minutes is basically... about 420 seconds, and you divide that by 115, it gives you about 3.6, roughly 4 frames per minute that it is pulling out. That's not very high resolution to analyze the video. Okay, a sample of video frames will be taken. So it does say at the bottom that it will take a sample of the video frames within this to go create the analysis.
So while this is happening, I'm using on my desktop a thing called rewind.ai.
Yeah.
And that is screenshotting me every 5 seconds.
Right.
And I can later go back and search and say, what was that Google Doc I was writing that had this great to-do list in it? I forgot what I called it. And it will find that for me. And the caveat is it has to be on the screen for at least 5 seconds. So If text is just zooming by, it won't get it. But for text that's on the screen for 5 seconds, it will.
Got it.
So I imagine this is similar. So if it's doing, if this is a 7 minute clip, so every 5 seconds.
Currently, because it's taking about 115,000 tokens, my estimate is that it is taking 4 screenshots a minute.
Okay.
It's taking a screenshot every 4 seconds. My mistake.
Okay, so then we end up with 15 screenshots per minute.
Correct.
And then plus whatever post-processing does the screenshot of text detection, it'll probably figure out, do some object detection in this case, 2 talking heads.
Correct.
And 2 very good talking heads.
Correct. So let's see what it does. It's still loading up. So this is not just the upload, but it's actually doing some kind of analysis on the video. It's probably running FFmpeg behind the scenes, creating the frames or generating the context for this particular prompt.
Now, is this publicly available right now? Can anyone sign up for Gemini Studio?
So as an individual organization, you can sign up for Gemini. As an individual user, sorry. You can sign up for Gemini 1.5 Pro. It's in preview. But if you are an organization, there's a wait list and it's still not being open to everyone. Okay, let's try the first query. Hopefully I will not mess it up this time. There you go. Can you please summarize the video in the doc or the discussion in this video clip? Now, I've generally found this response time to be decent, even though the upload time and the one-time processing is pretty expensive. The summarization across the video frames is not too bad. Let's see. Actually, it's already taken 30 seconds or almost 30 seconds. Yeah, so it's about 30 seconds to get a summary. Let's jump into the next question. Where let's ask it for a point by point view of both the speakers.
Okay.
Let's see what it says. As you can see, I've already used up 117,000 tokens to do this.
So this is interesting in that in this video, we were discussing the points of others. And so let's see if this, if Google AI Studio picks up on this.
Oh, there were other participants? I didn't think that there were other participants here.
Well, I wonder if it's recognizing, okay, maybe that it's recognizing the fact that we were conveying the viewpoints of others. That's good.
Why don't we just ask that question directly? So we should probably ask the viewers, the speakers expressing their own views or the views of others. Let's see what it comes up with. Okay, so it says that the speakers are expressing their own views. That doesn't seem very accurate. I don't know if you could make that out of the transcript.
Can you ask it to attribute? Maybe can you just tell it they were summarizing a discussion, and can you attribute
the views
to particular users on the discussion?
Right. The views expressed, the views on the screen.
Yeah. Let's try that.
And just for context, we will pull up parts of the video and look at exactly what it had. Okay, so speaker one, Dr. Triopas. Okay, so over here it actually does say that the views of other participants are the same as the views expressed on screen.
Can you scroll back up to the other participants part? I want to see. Okay.
Claude is better at coding than GPT-4 Turbo. I think that is one of the comments. Or was that my comment? I can't remember.
But it's interesting. This Claude is better with low resource languages. So we looked this up in the discussion forum, and they were saying low resource languages. The person who used that comment was talking about spoken languages, not written languages.
Huh.
And they were saying low resource languages that I or other people know could test, including several German, Swiss dialects, and Azerbaijani.
Interesting.
So when they meant low resource, they weren't saying like Arduino is a low resource usage. They were meaning low resource, like there's not a lot of training data.
Got it.
So that was the context.
Interesting. Let's ask it to actually create the specific clips. Let's see if it can do this. Let's see if we can find that out. Okay, let's pull this up. Shall I call out each
clip? Okay, sure.
And you want to pull up the video at your end? I'm going to stop sharing this one here.
No problem.
And I think we need more screens to be displayed all at the same time.
Let's give this a try. Okay.
Okay, so the first one, at 3 seconds, we say Opus is much more capable than GPT-3. And GPT-4 at the 3-second interval. So why don't we just play the clip and see what we get.
Well, that wasn't accurate.
That wasn't accurate. Okay, let's figure out. Okay. It says Claude 3 Opus is better at providing context for its answers at 41 seconds.
Look at this one. Okay, 41 seconds. For coding, another vote for Claude Opus.
So that wasn't what we... That's not what it was mentioning in the in the table.
Yeah, I think it's hallucinating a bit over here, okay, trying to figure out. Let's go to some of the other comments. Okay, so at 3 minutes, 37 seconds, GPT-4 is better for programming.
3 minutes, 37 seconds.
Yeah. But in my personal experience, I found that.
So that's when you were talking about should you try them both at the same time?
I really struggled. Correct. So I think it was a miss completely on that front. I think it's just really hallucinating when it is trying to tell us the clips.
Now I wonder if we tried a much simpler video, like a tourism video promoting some country, right, where there was like a story arc, if it would get it better. Because we did have a very nuanced discussion. So I wonder if it said, you know, visit this country and see the beaches, the mountains, and the food.
Yeah.
Right. I'm guessing it would probably be better at doing that, because we were talking about very particular things and there might not be a lot of differentiation even within its parameters.
Agreed. Yeah, so this is definitely very exciting. I want to experiment with this a little bit more to really understand how it's processing all of this data and all this information. I do see that if you're going to take only one frame every 4 or 5 seconds, there's a lot of information you are going to lose. And so unless you get really, really good at parsing everything in there and extrapolating, you're not going to be able to answer these nuanced questions. And I think that's one of the big issues or concerns that I have. So we will continue to experiment with this. Let us know if you've tried Gemini 1.5 Pro and let us know what it's been really, really good at. We'd love to get your views on it, and we will continue experimenting with different questions, different inputs, and different modes as well.
All right. Well, it was really neat seeing Gemini AI, seeing what you can do with 1 million tokens, uploading an entire video. Now, how do you see this changing your usage of things? Do you still see RAG as being relevant? I mean, we talked about that with Taranjeet.
Yeah. I actually think RAGs are still relevant. They have a separate use case. However, when it comes to a lot of the, you know, very specific kind of data processing where the context has to be large for it to make sense. Video is a classic example where, because videos basically are nothing but 24 frames per second at a minimum, and then you expand that as to how many minutes or hours you're going to run your video, that context, which is temporal in nature, needs to have all of those frames in place for you to be able to analyze it appropriately. So large context windows have a place for a bunch of very specific use cases, video being one of them, and RAGs have a separate place where you need quick answers really fast from your LLM. So I think each has their own place. The area of these large context windows and their use cases have literally just come up. They're still in preview. So we have to see how that evolves. We have to see how much fine-tuning you can do. We also have to explore how much context is lost in the middle. You know, the needle in the haystack problem. If you have a very, very large context, how much of it does the LLM really take in as it is trying to, you know, parse all of that context, understand the context, and then give you relevant answers. So there's a lot of experimentation that's still pending. There's lots to be learned about how these models behave and operate. So I actually think that there's got to be a role for these large models. And at the same time, the old ones have their own place too.
It is a dynamic, shifting landscape. We're still
it's like every week.
Yeah, we have all these tools available. We're trying to figure out what goes with what. I'm sure we'll figure out. Okay, we use the sledgehammer here and the socket wrench here, and eventually we're going to have this sorted out. But right now, it is just it's the Wild West, and in the funnest of ways. It's really neat to be able to have all these neat tools to play with. And
I agree.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Do more things quickly. Okay. I really want to try out the Opus clip that you sent me. Be able to use Opus to select portions of videos. We'll give that a shot.
No, it's actually, lots of exciting stuff happening. But I want to remind our audience that there's, while we're talking about all these amazing advancements and leveraging all of these LLMs to do these fun things, there are still a lot of the basics that we still need to see a lot of, you know, AWS users actually adopt. And one of the big areas where we constantly see tons of money being wasted is in the area of, you know, AWS cost optimization, particularly in EC2 and RDS related costs. So, Stephen, you have a bunch of stuff that you should be talking about, or I think are going to talk about today around RDS cost optimization. My one request to everyone is take all of those insights, save a bunch of money, and then use it to experiment with this amazing new AI technology that we've all been exploring today. So what do we have in store today, Stephen?
Yeah, let's dive right into it. We've had several RDS launches over the last couple of weeks, and I want to take some time to consolidate all of those. Let's just go over them one by one. And like you said, Rahul, at the core of everything we're doing, right? AI is at the periphery. It's starting to permeate things, but at the core, you still need compute and database. And there's a huge amount of room to optimize there. So let's go over all the different RDS announcements that we've had over the last couple of weeks.
Sounds great. Let's dive right in.
All right. Here's all of our RDS announcements. So again, RDS, Amazon's relational database service. We've got Aurora. We've got the hosted RDS. We had a lot of blog posts about RDS recently. I want to share my screen on the CloudFix blog. So go to cloudfix.com/blog. We'll put this on the screen. Here we go. So you can search or just scroll down for the most recent articles. As you can see, we've got RDS multi-availability zone, RDS Aurora Postgres, QL retype and resize, Graviton added to the RDS MySQL optimizer. And then for Aurora, there's an IO optimized pricing. There is IO1 to IO2. So let's go over all of these. I'll put this on, go to cloudfix.com/blog if you want to read in the details. Let's just put the list on the screen. Here we go. So how to save on RDS. So the big one, and like you saw throughout the show, you saw the little video clips that I had done with the butcher paper and the Sharpie marker, is EBS. So what we see is EBS starts with IO1 and IO2. That's really, really expensive. I'm going to play that clip one more time just so we get on the same page. Oh, that makes me laugh. Okay, so what we're trying to show there is that with EBS, which are, you know, the volumes that are backing your RDS instances, with EBS, you can have these IO1 and IO2. And that's fine for prod if you need that really fast, you need the low latency, you need the huge amount of IOPS. But then what happens is you copy paste, and that's what I was trying to show there with the mouse. You copy paste this configuration to your pro, to your dev, to your staging, to your UAT, to your other databases. And this is the little setting, which is just one line in your CloudFormation template. This little setting is going to propagate all those copy and paste. And before you know it, you're paying 10x what you need to just for these database volumes. So that's why with CloudFix, you can make that switch, IO1, IO2 to GP3. So that's what you want to do. We will scan all of your instances. We'll scan all of your RDS and the RDS finder fixer. Sorry, excuse me. The EPS IO1, IO2 to GP3 finder fixer is going to find this, which is expensive, and switch it over here. This is inexpensive. That's what you want to do. That is the IO1, IO2 to GP3 finder fixer. Another one is the instance retyping. Now, under the hood, that uses Compute Optimizer. We talked about that. With Compute Optimizer, you can retype your instances to either AMD or Graviton. Either is going to provide you a value over Intel. You can run RDS, perfectly happy to run on Graviton or AMD. And also, so we have a blog post about that. That is our Graviton added to the RDS MySQL Optimizer. So let's put that article back on the screen for a second. There it is. Graviton added to the RDS MySQL Optimizer. So with this one, you can, it will scan your accounts and propose to you where it's appropriate to change your instances over to Graviton 3. So you log into the CloudFix control panel and you'll see this proposed change. You click that button and it goes off ready to go. The blog post is really informative. We had an interview with Arthur Petit-Pierre. He is Graviton lead. Had actually two interviews with him, and we had an interview with Rick Oakes about Compute Optimizer. This is showing you how it works. It'll give you this RDS optimized instances finder fixer that encapsulates several finder fixers, including the Graviton. It will show you, you log in, it'll show you, oh, look, here's an m6g.xlarge that's running, and here is the fix. Okay, so it's currently an m5.xlarge, and it can change it to an m6g.xlarge. And you see that's moving it, it's modernizing it, and it's also changing it from the Intel instance to the Graviton instance. This is going to save you money and not sacrifice performance. That's really exciting. Okay, back on stage here. There we go. So that's retyping from Intel to either AMD or Graviton. The other one is resizing. So often we find ourselves in this situation. Can you see that? RDS instance size maxed out. I think it's our database, it's critical infrastructure, but then things change, load changes, or again, you're in that dev test UAT scenario where you don't need this huge size. You just need to make sure your code works with the database. And so you can go here, I'm really proud of this print, go here, slide, notch that size down a little bit. And with Compute Optimizer and with the instance resize tool from CloudFix, we're going to do this for you. We're going to make sure this works. We're not going to sacrifice performance in any way. We'll make sure you have those good overheads. But yes, you don't want to be paying for this 32x large when you can get by with this. This is going to save you on your RDS costs as well. With Aurora, there is IO optimized pricing. So with Aurora, there's a thing called IO optimized. And what that does is if your IO cost is more than 25%, with IO optimized, you pay just a fixed cost for IO, and you pay a higher rate for storage. And so the question is, when do you want to use which one? So you can either look at your usage, historical usage, or with CloudFix, we will calculate that for you, and we will only propose this change where it makes sense. I'll share the CloudFix blog again. We've got a great blog post on that, if I do say so, which I do. Here is the Aurora optimized made easy. So you can, here's the challenge of IO optimization. It shows you the pricing. So you see here Aurora standard versus Aurora IO optimized. So with IO optimized, you pay a higher instance rate per hour, but you're not paying IO. So if that works out, you can think of it as like two different lines, but one steeper than the other, and where, but then they have a different intercept and where they cross, that's what you want. There's a certain threshold, we're past that, I optimized, makes sense. So we're going to calculate that for you. We show, like we said, we're transparent. We show exactly how we're calculating it. You could do this yourself if you wanted to, but you'd also just use CloudFix, and that will be wrapped up in the CloudFix Finder Fixer. So check it out here. Go to Advanced, RDS Retype IO Optimized. That's going to show you, that's where it is. It's in the Advanced panel. You click on here in the Show Details, and what's going to show you? It's going to show you a possible fix. So it says current engine Aurora PostgreSQL is version 3.11. So not every engine version supports this, but for ones that do, you can make the switch. And it's going to show you the one. It's going to show you the potential savings. And so if you just make that one switch, it can save you thousands per year. And again, it's just, this is not changing performance in any way. This is a billing and accounting thing. It's not going to change the performance in any way at all. So where this makes sense, you definitely want to turn this on. You could implement this yourself, but with CloudFix, it'll do all the analysis for you and make sure you only turn it on when it makes sense. Because if you turn it on when it doesn't make sense, you'll be paying that higher rate for no reason. So looking at our list here, switching to single AZ deployments. That's another situation similar to that dev and test versus prod. Maybe for your prod database, you really want that multi-AZ reliability. So AZs are availability zones. So you have a region, and within a region, you have multiple availability zones. An availability zone is one or more physical buildings. Each availability zone within a region has distinct power, distinct risks to various, you know, whether it's lightning or flooding, whatever risk they determine. AZs are meant to give you protection from the natural disasters and internet connectivity problems within a region. Now, we found AZs themselves, it's rare that a whole AZ just goes down. And with multi-AZ deployments, you're paying a lot for this extra bit of reliability. And maybe it makes sense, maybe it doesn't. But the key thing is you need to know when you're running multi-AZ, and then you can make an educated choice of when to switch. So with CloudFix, the multi-AZ, this is not an automatic finder fixer, because switching from single to multi-AZ, that would require some judgment on your infrastructure that we can't and don't want to make in an automated way. Let me put this blog post on screen. Here is the multi-AZ finder fixer. We go into details about what availability zones are, what regions are, how this all works. The different redundancy levels. I couldn't find any data on exactly how reliable AZs are. That isn't published. But we know anecdotally, AZs rarely just vanish off the face of the earth. And it's this trade-off of complexity versus price. So again, with multi-AZ, you're paying at least double, right? You need an extra set of nodes in that other region. Plus, you have this cross-AZ traffic. And so we go over that here. We go over the prices, the challenges, the costs. Here's a cur query so you can find your multi-AZ instances. And here's how you modify it. Again, we are transparent in what we're doing. We're not trying to sell any kind of secret optimization sauce that only we know. This is how to do it. We have done this at scale across thousands and thousands of accounts. We do that continuous monitoring, continuous process, and put all of these savings opportunities in one place. So that's the multi-AZ finder fixer. You can see this in this RDS panel. You see there's lots of things there. There's the RDS optimize. Click over in the CloudFix. It's in the advanced tab. Go over to RDS. There you go. RDS retype to single availability zone. Let me zoom in there so you can see it. This one has its own panel. You can see the list of multi-AZ deployments, and it will show you the potential savings if you switch it over. And you can see this is going to be at least half. There we go. Look at that. At least half. And so the situations where this makes sense, you're going to want to go through these. Again, we can't have a fixer for this because it can't be automated, because you want to think, well, where's the rest of your infrastructure? Is this a database where you're willing to pay that extra cost? But at least you can see it all in one place. And maybe you have a service that's deprecated. It used to be really popular and used to be mission critical, but now it just sees occasional use, and you no longer want to pay that multi-AZ cost. So this is a great opportunity to continually reevaluate, you know, once a month or once a week, however often you want to, scroll through this tab, scroll through this panel. Oh, interesting. You know what? This database here,
that is no longer worth $7,000 a year to our organization to keep that as a multi-AZ when we don't need to hedge that bet against that AZ falling over anymore. Okay, let's go back to the main list. Let's have a, oops, sorry about that. Too many tabs. Back to the main list. Here we go. So there is the five that we've published lately. It's EBS volumes, IO1, IO2 to GP3. Again, remember this guy, IO1, IO2 to GP3. Make that switch. This one makes sense. And for this one, we will analyze the amount of throughput that you're using and make sure we only propose this where it makes sense. I believe we have, let's show you the difference here. Oh, it makes me grin when I see it. Okay, so when you're using an IO1, if you're using 200,000 IOPS and a GP3 could not possibly keep up, we won't propose a change. But if you're using an IO1 or an IO2, you're only using 10,000 IOPS, or a GP3 could easily handle that, then really the only thing the GP3 couldn't keep up with is that sub-millisecond latency versus single millisecond latency. So you have to decide, is that 10x cost worth it to you? And probably not. So that way you can see it. You can see it all right there. You can make your decision. If it really is worth it to you, then keep it as IO1, IO2. Why not? But if you'd rather have the money, you can keep it as GP. You can switch it over to GP3. It's a really easy fix. It happens instantaneously. So yeah, that's that one. That's the biggest one. Next, look at the instance retyping, AMD to AMD or Graviton. And also resizing that instance. Remember this visual here. Why pay for this one when all you need is that one or that one? And then plus you're leveraging these awesome tools that AWS already has for you. And we just make it, put them all there in one place. You can see the cost trade-off versus the instance size. I think that's the really, really cool thing about CloudFix is that you see it all in one place. Right? It's easy to have this mental checklist. Okay, I got to go to this API for this. I got to check out my curve report in this dashboard here. Oh, and this person maintains a Google Sheet for this one. No, CloudFix is all in one place. You can see the savings opportunity, so you can get your brain into that mindset. Look it over once a week, once a month, whenever you want to do, every other week, and look at, okay, what are the opportunities? Remember, things are changing all the time. Maybe a service that used to be busy isn't busy anymore. So look at the opportunities for deciding, is it worth it to be on AMD? Or excuse me, is it worth it to have a highly over-provisioned instance that you don't need? Or should you switch it over to one that still has enough headroom? That's compute optimizer guarantees that. Still has enough headroom to serve historical loads, but isn't way over-provisioned. So you're not paying that extra cost. IO optimized. Again, we look at the historical usage patterns. If it makes sense, switch that over. You could do that yourself. It's an easy calculation. Check out the blog post. Or if you're a CloudFix customer, CloudFix would do this for you, and then multi-AZ deployments. Whew. There is a lot there. There's a lot of potential for savings, and that's the great thing is when you apply all these savings, they compound, and then you free up money for Bedrock and generative AI and all these really, really neat things rather than just overpaying for a database service that you don't need.
Awesome.
All right. Well, that has been a long episode. It's really been interesting to figure out exactly what breakfast we can order. I'm a bit hungry now. And Raul, it's your evening. Ah, that pushed the, I meant to flip it over. I ended up pushing it to last week's conclusion here. Sorry, Raul, let's switch it back. Sorry about that. Let's do this again. Well, that was a great episode. It was really fun to experiment with Gemini Pro and really get a feel for what a 1 million length context window is. It was great to see the compute optimizer announcements, all the other AWS announcements. There's so much happening. It feels like it's been a jam-packed week. It's only Tuesday. What's in store for the rest of the week, Raul?
Okay, again, there's tons more experimentation to do. We are still playing around with Claude 3, with Opus, with Haiku, with Sonnet, as well as Gemini 1.5 Pro. There's just so much stuff that's going on. Google just announced API access for Gemini 1.5 Pro. So we're going to see what new capabilities that unleashes. So stay tuned. As always, please subscribe, send us your feedback, and let us know what you would like us to talk about on the show or answer for you. We love to do experimentation. So if there are things that you would like us to try out and share our feedback and our responses to those experiments, we would be happy to do so. So check out AWS Made Easy on YouTube, LinkedIn, as well as on X. And yeah, we look forward to talking to you all next week.
All right. We'll see you all next time. Have a good one. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Some tools just find AWS cost savings and make you do all the work. Visualizing cost opportunities is great, but that's not enough. CloudFix, on the other hand, actually delivers those savings for you. And you don't need to worry, because CloudFix is AWS recommended and easy to use. It's the only tool that fixes cost saving opportunities and not just finds. It's the easiest way to save money on AWS. It's all 100% automatic and risk-free. And the best part of all, it works non-stop. Stop overspending on AWS and click on the button to start saving now.